I'm actually a Dutchman. I love the Irish. I want to tell you that. I was in Ireland for six short months at the U.S. Embassy in Dublin, and it was fantastic. It was my favorite country of the countries that I've served in. And speaking of, you know, nationalities, European nationalities, in honor of one of the attendees of this event, who when we first met, actually right here in this auditorium, when we first met, told me a joke about a Dutchman named Huizinga from Hudsonville. He told me the joke because I am a Dutchman named Huizinga from Hudsonville. I'd like to start with a joke, but it's not going to be the one about the Dutchman named Huizinga from Hudsonville. It's an old joke about Europe. Actually, interestingly enough, it's the only joke I've ever heard about Europe. And I was looking on the internet, it's kind of the only joke about Europe. Very interesting. It goes like this. Heaven is a place where the police are English, the chefs are Italian, the auto mechanics are German, the lovers are French, and it's all organized by the Swiss. Hell is a place where the police are German, the chefs are English, I can vouch for that, the auto mechanics are French, the lovers are Swiss, and it's all organized by the Italians. Thank you for laughing. That joke is getting less funny all the time. Why? Because the European Union, with its habit of encouraging everybody to get into everybody else's business, has gone a long way toward remolding Europe into something that actually looks like the joke I just told. Before the summer is out, Britain might decide to leave the EU. The referendum is on June 23. Greece is little more than a protectorate of the International Monetary Fund, the European Commission, and the European Central Bank. Schengen, the system of open travel across borders within the EU, is in danger of being abolished. Devastating terrorist attacks have occurred regularly since the 2004 Madrid train bombings all the way to the November Paris attack. And the threat of jihadist terrorism remains palpable throughout Europe. So how did this all come about? In my book, I contend that the European Union's commitment to supranational, it's hard to pronounce, supranational, that the European Union's commitment to supranational Europe-wide governance above the level of the nation states and overriding the sovereign powers of the member states is eroding democracy in Europe, threatening human rights, and putting the EU on a collision course with the United States. There are five major arguments in the book. First, the EU is transforming Europe from a continent of democratically accountable nation states into a post-democratic order in which voters have little say in how they are governed. Second, the Eurozone crisis, the migrant crisis, and the increased risk of terrorism in Europe have all occurred largely as a result of the EU's disregard of both basic economics and even of cultural self-preservation in the pursuit of its supranationalist dream of global governance. Third, because of their different views on national sovereignty and democratic accountability, the United States and the European Union are on a collision course. Fourth, the fact that Europe is largely post-Christian, while the US system of government is based on a Judeo-Christian worldview, accounts for a radical difference between American and European views on the role of government. And fifth, many of the new human rights promoted by the EU are actually harmful to human rights because they contradict tradition, human nature, and the fact that human beings are not just individuals, but are embedded in family, religion, and community. We can't handle all of the themes in this talk, so stop worrying. I'd like to concentrate on two things. First, I'd like to give you a little introduction to the EU, what it is and how it works. And second, I'd like to examine the clash of visions between the US and the EU. First, an introduction to the EU. What is the EU? That is the question. It is very, very hard to say what the EU is because so many different interests, values, and people coexist within the EU. Also, the EU is unprecedented. Nothing like the EU has ever existed before. Certainly, the European Union is unlike any other international arrangement or organization. Although economic integration has been the key accomplishment of the EU, the EU is much more than, say, a free trade bloc like Canada, the United States, and Mexico under NAFTA. Neither is the EU like any international organization that at first glance might seem comparable. Take the Organization of American States, the OAS. Both the EU and the OAS are regional organizations. And just as the OAS is Pan-American, the EU, encompassing the 35 states of North, Central, and South America, the OAS, so the EU is Pan-European, including almost all of the countries of Western Europe and by far most of the countries of Central and Eastern Europe. In fact, let's try something. Raise your hand if you know which three countries are the only Western European countries that are not members of the EU. Oh, look, my daughter. My daughter Sarah is raising her hand. Sarah. Switzerland, Iceland, and Norway. She's right. She's so smart and only 15 years old. My daughter was not coached. So the OAS and the EU are both pan-regional. But the similarities between the OAS and the EU end there. The 28 EU member states with their constant coordination in every possible policy issue and their powerful common institutions in Brussels are much more closely integrated than the member states of the OAS or any other international organization. So the EU is much more than just a garden variety international organization. But neither is the EU anything like a federal state. The EU is not a United States of Europe. The EU member states continue to exist as independent nations. So again, I ask, what is the EU? When all is said and done, what it comes down to is that the EU is a supranationalist project. It functions in significant areas independently of its member states, via institutions that exercise sovereign powers at a supranational level above the national level. The EU member states, in the interest of realizing an unprecedented degree of stability, peace, and prosperity, are pooling and thus relinquishing significant elements of their national sovereignty. They are ceding large aspects of their governing and lawmaking powers to the supranational EU institutions that are distinct from the EU member states and that function independently of the member states above the national level. The essence of the European project, not just the nuts and bolts of how the EU works, but the hope behind the European dream, the heart and soul and mind of the EU is precisely this supranationalism. The process of European integration, the project that eventually birthed the EU, arose out of the ashes of World War II, the most devastating, destructive war the world has ever known. European leaders after World War II were determined that war should never again arise from European soil, that violent conflicts among European nation states, especially between France and Germany, should never happen again. This was a noble vision. Above all, this was an understandable vision, given what had happened to Europe in World War II and shortly before that in World War I. And despite all the problems the EU has caused and its vision has caused, it remains a powerful vision today, the vision of a harmonious and peaceful Europe united in the European Union with Finns and Cypriots and Irish and Dutch and Germans and French and everybody else all working together for a better Europe and a better world. So how far has the supranational governance gone in the EU? To give just a few examples, trade policy is made almost exclusively at EU level. Germany does not make its own independent trade policy. Neither does France or Spain or any other EU member state. The EU member states have given up their right to make their own trade policy. The EU makes one trade policy for all and concludes trade agreements with outside parties, such as the US-EU trade agreement that's currently being negotiated. The US is not negotiating this trade agreement with Europe, with Germany or France or the UK. It's negotiating the trade agreement with the EU. A side comment, as we saw here in the Michigan primary last week, with the victories of Bernie Trump and Donald Sanders, we saw that trade policy is extremely important to real people and for very understandable reasons. It's hard for me to imagine a vibrant democracy in which trade policy is not made by governments that are directly accountable to voters. Another example of the EU's supranationalism. In the Eurozone, monetary policy is the exclusive province of the European Central Bank. The central banks of the individual member states cannot make monetary policy on their own to fit their distinct national circumstances. The Greeks, who have completely lost their sovereign decision-making powers over their own economy, could tell you all about that, as could the Germans, whose retirement savings are earning interest rates at way below what would be appropriate for their economy, and whose hard-earned money is propping up Greece, a debtor whose creditworthiness is close to zero. A third example of the EU's supranationalism is immigration. The development of a common immigration policy, including on asylum and external border control, is under the jurisdiction of the EU, not the member states. This is the central factor, or a central factor, in the migrant crisis as having gotten out of control, and in the anger and frustration of people who fear that their way of life is being threatened by the intake of virtually unlimited numbers of refugees without their having a say in the matter at all. All in all, according to estimates, about one half to two thirds of the laws and regulations in which people in the EU are subject are made at EU level, not by national governments that are accountable to the voters. So around 60% of the regulations that say a Portuguese or a Pole is subject to do not originate in the Portuguese or the Polish parliament, but come from the EU in Brussels. But, and here's where it gets more interesting for the United States, the European Union is not just about Europe. The EU sees its supranationalist approach as a model for a new way to order the world. The EU's supranationalism is all about global governance, extending the EU's form of supranational governance on a global scale in order to realize world peace by overcoming the unlimited national sovereignty of nations, which the EU believes is the root of war among nations. And here the EU does have real credibility. After all, it is the only actually functioning model of how such global governance might work. So what is global governance? It's very hard to find a good definition of global governance. Here's how I would define it. Global governance is the attempt to introduce a global rule of law in the interest of achieving an unprecedented degree of global peace, stability and prosperity, not via a one-world government. We're not talking about a one-world government, but rather by the development of an ever more comprehensive network of international institutions that administer an ever greater body of international law to which nation states are subject. that binds them not only in their foreign policy, but also in substantial areas of their domestic policy. The key to global governance is the development of a global rule of law, whereby no one knows exactly what this global rule of law will look like in the end, and no one really knows exactly whether an end is even meant to be achieved. Another fascinating thing about the EU and the global governance movement is that it's process, process, process. It's not necessarily results, it's process. So back for a minute to the European level. How does the EU, this attempt to build a supranational democracy, this model for global governance, how does it actually work? Has it been successful? How well can it work? And above all, can this supranational democracy really be democratically accountable? How does it work? Primarily via powerful centralizing institutions over and above the member state governments and distinct from the member state governments. Most of these institutions, not all, but most of these institutions are headquartered in Brussels, Belgium. Let me quickly summarize some of the most important EU institutions. First, the European Commission. This is the EU's executive arm. It implements and enforces EU regulation throughout the EU. But it also has an important legislative function. It's an executive arm, but has a legislative function. With rare exceptions, the European Commission is the only institution in the EU that has the power to propose EU legislation. In other words, to write bills like our Congress writes bills. Second, the Council of Ministers. Council of Ministers is the institution within which the member state governments are directly represented. It has 10 different formations depending on the policy area. This is also typical of the EU. It's one council of ministers, but there's 10 different councils. For example, the Foreign Affairs Council brings the foreign ministers together. The Environment Council brings the environmental affairs ministers together. The ECOFIN Council brings the economic and finance ministers together, etc. In the Council of Ministers, representatives of the member state governments at cabinet level, ministerial level, work together to coordinate almost all policies in their domain, domestic and foreign, political and economic. The European Council is distinct from the Council of Ministers. The European Council is atop the Council of Ministers. At least once every 2 months, the member state heads of government meet as the European Council to make decisions that are above the pay grade of the Council of Ministers. Both the European Council and the European Commission have a president, by the way. Neither of the two presidents is elected by voters, and neither is a part of any national government. The presidents set the agenda for each of their institutions respectively and coordinate among the officials of their institutions. In terms of protocol, both presidents are at the head of state level, even though they don't head a state. Our head of state, the US president, be he Obama or Bush or Clinton or maybe Trump or Sanders, our head of state, the US president, meets at least once a year with both of the EU presidents together. If the US president would dare to meet with either of these two presidents alone at a US-EU summit, for example, there would be an outcry in the EU. Both presidents jealously guard their status, and neither one would allow the other one to act as if he could speak for the whole EU without the other. Seen from the outside, and seen from the inside, actually, it's a bizarre situation. Then we have the European Parliament. The European Parliament is the parliament, the Congress of the EU. But like all EU institutions, it's not directly comparable to its counterparts in national governments. The European Parliament does not make legislation. The European Commission, as I said, makes legislation. But the Parliament does, together with the Council of Ministers, approve all legislative proposals drafted by the Commission. The Parliament also doesn't do many other things most national parliaments do. It doesn't have the power to levy taxes, for example. Also, very interesting and significant, there is no majority party representing the government party and no minority party representing the opposition because there is no government in the EU and thus no opposition. Rather, in the EU, everyone governs together in a hybrid system of supranational governance. And I imagine that's one reason they use the word governance so often rather than the word government. The EU also has a de facto Supreme Court, the European Court of Justice. It is effectively a constitutional court, even though the EU officially has no constitution. It does have a constitution, but officially it doesn't have a constitution. The Court of Justice's main accomplishment over the years is that it has successfully asserted the primacy of EU law over national law. If the Court of Justice decides that a national law or even a clause in a national constitution conflicts with the EU treaties or with EU legislation, that law or that part of an EU member state's constitution is officially null and void. There is disagreement around this, a lot of disagreement around this, but generally this is the accepted state of affairs in the EU. So imagine if there were a United Nations court that could decide that a US law or that a clause in the US Constitution conflicted with the UN Charter, and that could thereby overturn US law or even the US Constitution. This is a situation that does exist in the EU. So the EU is completely different from any other political entity in the world. A final example that I can't resist from my experience as a diplomat. Although foreign policy is supposedly a domain of the EU member states, supposedly the EU does not do foreign policy officially, it's the EU member states. Nevertheless, the EU itself has become a huge foreign policy player. First, the EU member state foreign ministers, as I mentioned, meet monthly to coordinate their foreign policies with each other. Second, the EU has created its own de facto foreign minister with the title of High Representative of the European Union for Foreign Affairs and Security Policy. It's a long one. She chairs the monthly foreign affairs ministers' meetings and she sets the agenda for those meetings. She also travels extensively as the foreign policy representative of the EU. She, and not the foreign minister of Great Britain or Germany or France, she, the EU High Representative, was John Kerry's principal European partner in the nuclear negotiations with Iran, for example. Serving the High Representative, the EU also has created its own de facto diplomatic corps, its own State Department, its own foreign ministry. It's called the European External Action Service. Day to day, the EU is as important a foreign policy player as Germany, France, or Great Britain, the three largest EU member states. It is more important, much more important, than any of the mid-sized or small EU member states. This is an amazing thing. One of the US's most important foreign policy partners is a something that's not a country, with a government that's not a government, a foreign minister who's not a foreign minister, in a diplomatic corps that's not a diplomatic corps, with all of these elements making and implementing foreign policy on behalf of an organization that no one has been able to define in a way that everyone can agree on. So that was my introduction to the EU. I'm glad I've cleared away the confusion. What is at the root of all this? How did this strange new thing called the EU come about? That brings us to the second of the two topics I want to cover, the transatlantic clash of visions between the US and the EU. This is a complex topic, of course, but in principle, what Americans must understand is that the EU and the US have fundamentally different visions of the world. The US, and of course I'm generalizing here, but generalizations are necessary. The US vision of the world and of international affairs is that of a world of sovereign nations. The US hopes to achieve a more peaceful and prosperous world by promoting democracy and the rule of law so that the world system is distinguished by democratically accountable governments of nation states accountable to their citizens that cooperate peacefully with each other. The US government sees itself as responsible primarily to its citizens. It desires peace and cooperation with other countries, but it is not responsible to other countries or to international organizations or to international law in the same way it is responsible to its citizens. And no law, treaty, or international agreement can possibly be binding on the U.S. government if it violates the U.S. Constitution. It's the Constitution and the Constitution alone that is accepted by the American people as the basic law against which the legitimacy of all other laws, treaties, and agreements must be judged. And here, the concept of we the people is crucial. It's what makes the U.S. idea of national sovereignty morally compelling, because it affirms the dignity of the human person. Sovereignty in the U.S. system resides in the citizens of the nation, endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. It does not reside in the government of the nation. It resides in the citizens. The EU vision of the world, on the other hand, is of a post-nation state world in which war and conflicts between nation states are overcome because the full sovereignty of nation states has been relinquished to a system of global governance based on a growing web of international organizations administering a growing body of international law. Even though the Western and Central European countries remain our most important allies, and hopefully will remain our most important allies, this difference, this clash of visions, puts the EU and the US on a collision course. In principle, if not, thank God, always in practice. For one thing, and I've experienced this myself many, many times, anti-Americanism is an inevitable outgrowth of the European idea. The US as the world's most powerful nation state and one that jealously guards its national sovereignty, by its very existence, stands in the way of the EU vision of a world that has evolved beyond the nation state. We are the big obstacle in the way of the EU vision of the world. There are many factors that have led to this difference between the US and the EU. Not just the one I mentioned before of the European experience of World War II and the desire to do away with conflicts between European nations. I'd like to mention one other central factor, one that I delve deeply into in my book. This is the religious difference between the US and the EU. The US is the most Judeo-Christian, if I can use that term, of the modern developed societies of the world. The EU, by contrast, is largely secular. The US system of government is based on a very sober, very Judeo-Christian view of human nature and thus of government. This is the whole reason for the separation of powers and the checks and balances foreseen in the US Constitution. As explained in the Federalist Papers, which I would recommend, I'd recommend you read the Federalist Papers after you read my book. As explained in the Federalist Papers, perhaps the greatest defense of the US Constitution ever written, the separation of powers and the checks and balances provided in the US Constitution were necessary because power tends to corrupt and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Someone famous said this once, I can't remember who said that. It was Lord Acton. The anthropology of the Federalist Papers was deeply indebted to Christianity, and that regardless of whether the authors were themselves believing Christians or not. The authors, Alexander Hamilton, James Madison, and John Jay, accepted that human beings, while capable of great good, were also flawed and limited, sinful, as Christians would put it. Therefore, the power of human government had to be limited and separated into multiple centers, so that the flawed human beings who hold governmental power could not impose a tyranny on everyone else. And these views on human nature that informed the Federalist Papers and that informed the US Constitution are still the prevailing instinctive views of Americans today. And that, again, regardless of whether most Americans are believing Christians or not. Culturally, America is still Judeo-Christian. The EU, on the other hand, flows out of a basically secular, social democratic view of human nature, out of the idea that social justice can be achieved through government action and government planning. And this is not just a can be achieved. This is a must be achieved for most people in post-Christian Europe, and certainly for the governing elites. This world is all there is. Out of that flows the presuppositional conviction animating most European elites that the highest justice must be determined by human beings and pursued via politics and government. And believers in the European idea in the EU take it one step further. Utopia can be achieved through supranational politics. They hope, I don't know if they believe, but they hope. They hope that ultimately world peace will be achievable through the new structures of governance that will arise out of the global governance project. Structures that will probably be modeled, if they ever happen, on the EU's structures of governance. So this is a radical clash of visions between the US and the EU. The clash between democratic sovereignty based in the nation state and global governance. This clash is rooted to a significant degree in the clash between a religiously informed worldview in the US and a non-religious worldview in the EU. Let me finish with some examples of how this clash of vision plays out, how the ideology of global governance, though extremely unrealistic, has real-world consequences. First, the war on terror. Whatever you want to call it, some people don't like the phrase war on terror, and I simply use it because it's the shortest phrase. This, whatever you want to call it, has been the number one foreign policy priority of the United States since September 11, 2001. In many ways, the EU has been our most important ally in this struggle, that must be said. But at the same time, the EU has often and repeatedly been one of our worst antagonists. Why? Because the advocates of the global governance ideology want to subject the US struggle against terrorism to a potentially crippling regime of international law. I will name just one of many examples of this, the war in Iraq. I thought I'd pick a non-controversial example. People now remember the controversy over the war as revolving around whether there were actually weapons of mass destruction hidden in Iraq. But before the invasion, almost everyone, including the French, the Germans, and for good measure the Russians, believed that Saddam Hussein did have weapons of mass destruction hidden in Iraq. The real dispute was whether a preventive attack was justified under international law and whether war could be legitimate without the approval of the UN Security Council. In other words, the real dispute was whether the US could do what it rightly or wrongly believed was necessary to protect the lives of its citizens without the explicit approval of the other four permanent members of the UN Security Council. Only the permanent members of the UN Security Council have a veto right, so they have to approve everything that the UN approves. Well, who are the other four members of the four permanent members of the UN Security Council? Great Britain, France, Russia, and China. The United States is the fifth. This was truly a battle of worldviews centered on the question of the legitimacy and authority of supranational governance. And the advocates of global governance believed that the US did not have the right to protect its citizens without a permission slip from Russia and a permission slip from China, to say nothing of a permission slip from France. Permission slip from Great Britain, that probably would have been okay. Now, honest people, as I alluded to before, honest people of goodwill disagree on Iraq. They disagree on much of what the United States has done to combat terrorism since 9/11, not just Bush, but also Obama. There's been little precedent to fall back on, and the information on which to base policy decisions in the struggle against terror is usually severely limited and often unverifiable. The issues are very complex. We are dealing with all shades of gray in the war on terror, and consequential mistakes have been made. In fact, we may never know, in many cases, whether we took the best approach. But the global governancers don't want to deal with the real world of uncertainty and ambiguity. They have their ideological blinders firmly set in place. They want to realize their globalist vision based on a caricature of reality, and that agenda has immeasurably hindered the prosecution of the war on terror. Here's a second example of the real-world consequences of the global governance ideology, the introduction of the euro. The idea of establishing the euro, the common currency of most, not all, EU member states, was not based on economics. The euro was a political idea that trumped economics. The euro's advocates have always said that they wanted the euro because they thought the euro would force Europeans via the back door, so to speak, to have a European political union. In other words, European voters were not interested in European political union. So European elites thought that they could make it unavoidable by introducing a common currency. But then political union didn't come because Europeans still didn't want it. Thus, in 2008, with the global financial crisis and the ensuing Eurozone debt crisis, the consequences of that decision to abuse economic fundamentals in order to achieve a political goal came home to roost. It is now very difficult to deny, and I noticed as I was writing the book, when I first started writing the book, it was easy to deny. A lot of people were still denying it. But now it's very difficult to deny the folly of introducing a common currency to widely divergent economies, such as Greece and Germany, with radically different levels of development and productivity. The euro has turned EU member states into debtors and creditors to each other. It has stoked resentment and animosity, and it's exacerbated economic decline. Finally, I'd like to name an obscure but very telling example of the clash of visions between the US and the EU. The UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. This is a very interesting example. The only countries in the entire world that haven't ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child are the US, Somalia, and South Sudan. If you know anything about Somalia and South Sudan, you might be saying, truly, we are in good company. The EU, naturally, with its belief in the UN and global governance and international law, is the world's foremost champion of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. So why hasn't the US ratified it? Who, after all, could possibly be against children and children's rights? What you'll usually read about this is that it is just another egregious example of the US as being a unilateralist hegemon. But there's much more to the story. The United States has not ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child because of the concerns of Americans, mainly conservative Americans, about three implications of this UN convention that remain unclear. First, it is unclear whether the convention could be interpreted to bestow upon children the right to have an abortion and the right to do so without parents' consent or knowledge. Second, it is unclear whether the convention calls into question the right of parents to discipline their children, especially to discipline their children corporally, to spank them. To go back to my family again, the two people who spanked me back in the day are right here in this audience. At the time, I had no doubt that they were violating my international rights as a child. The third problematic part of the convention is that it is unclear whether the UN convention might deny the right of parents to bring up their children in their own religion. The UN convention vests children with the right to freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. And with the other clauses explaining and not explaining what that means, it's unclear whether parents might be violating international law if they tell their reluctant 13-year-old that he or she must attend church with the rest of the family, just to give a banal everyday example. Of course, believers in global governance claim that these objections are ridiculous and without basis, but that is demonstrably untrue. Let me give you one example. UN conventions come with monitoring committees that evaluate countries' compliance with conventions that they have signed up to. Just this month, March 2016, the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child released its latest report measuring Ireland's compliance with the convention. And yes, This Dutchman named Huizinga from Hudsonville loves Ireland and St. Patrick's Day. So anyway, so they just released their latest report measuring Ireland's compliance. The committee's report lamented Ireland's not having legalized abortion, including abortion for children. And here I'm quoting from the report, word for word from the report. I quote, "The committee recommends that Ireland decriminalize abortion in all circumstances and review its legislation with a view to ensuring access by children to safe abortion and post-abortion care services," end quote. So let me conclude with a question posed toward the beginning of my remarks. What is the EU? By now you can see why most people don't know. Most Europeans don't know. Most educated, politically astute Europeans do not know what the European Union is. But the European Union's beating heart, what motivates its supporters, is the idea of achieving peace through supranational governance, and extended globally, achieving peace through global governance. And the question of democracy is at the core of all this. The EU has never squared the circle to fit supranational governance with democracy. It's never figured out how its supranational governments can be made democratically accountable to an adequate degree. The problem is that the circle can't be squared. As I argue in my book, and as I alluded to in my remarks, I wish I could have said more, the struggle between liberal democracy, democratic sovereignty, and global governance is at the deepest level a struggle to define the human person and the purpose of human life. In broad terms, the ideological roots of liberal democracy in the West are found in the Judeo-Christian view of an unchanging human nature embedded in tradition, religion, and family. The partisans of global governance come down on the side of a radically secularist, postmodern commitment to a new politics based on a new view of the human being, the autonomous individual, liberated from the constraints of religion, tradition, and even family, who can redefine himself and his identity according to his own individual choice. Choice is the absolute number one command, independent of traditional institutions and social connections. The ideas of individual autonomy and the malleability of human nature are making huge inroads in the United States too, as I discuss in more detail in the book. And contrary to what Americans tend instinctively to assume, we are not always in the lead. In many ways, the US is following the EU's lead regarding political, social, and economic trends. As a result, we are also experiencing threats on many fronts to our ability to exercise our freedom and our responsibilities under a reliable, just, and democratic rule of law. That's why it's very important for Americans to understand the debate at the heart of Europe's future. It's not important to understand all of the intricacies of how the EU works, but it's important to understand the debate at the heart of Europe's future about supranational governance. In many ways, the US and Europe will stand or fall together. And it's my hope that I express in the book that we can stand together rather than fall together. Thank you very much. Yes.
Thank you very much, Todd. What a wonderful lecture. We've at 12:45, we have lots of time for questions. So just raise your hand. We get the mic to you. If you'd like to say your name and then ask your question, we'll go from there. Thank you.
Just wondering, Tyler Wagamaker, just wondering if you could kind of unpack a little bit more of the upcoming vote with Great Britain and their commitment to the EU.
Yes, that's really, to me, the portentous question right now. The Eurozone can hardly be underestimated, that crisis, that continuing crisis. The migrant crisis can hardly be underestimated. But I mean, the question of whether Great Britain is going to leave the EU or not is incredibly important for the European Union, for the idea of supranational governance, and for the United States. The British are very conservative in the sense that they're very cautious. I personally think that's a good thing. I'm not sure that that's going to be a good thing in this case, because I think that the fears about making the radical change of leaving the EU might motivate enough British voters that they, in fact, will vote to stay. Right now, the polls that I recently saw actually gave a majority to, or a plurality to the leave vote. The important thing to remember about the Brexit, the British exit, the Brexit debate, is that as so often when it comes to the EU, what you read is not really the central matter. You read all kinds of things about the British are upset about free movement of people within the EU, so they're upset about non-EU, non-British EU citizens coming to Britain under the free movement of peoples and taking British social services and so forth. You read a lot about, you know, the financial center, the City of London, and that the financial center wants to protect its prerogatives against Eurozone regulation. And you read all kinds of other things about the issues. These are important issues, and they do matter to Brits. But the central issue is, do the British, I guess you could, there's two aspects to it. Do the British have a right to self-government? One. And two, are the British prepared to pay the price that they would have to pay leaving the EU in order to preserve their self-government? Now, I think you can make an incredibly good case that with 60% approximately of law and regulation that the British live under being made in Brussels and not being made by their parliament, that, you know, British self-government has in fact been significantly eroded by being EU members. One more comment. David Cameron, the Prime Minister, said that, okay, I'm going to renegotiate a new deal for Britain and the EU, and then after that new deal, we'll decide whether we stay or not. And David Cameron is campaigning for a yes vote to stay in the EU. Here's one thing that you probably read that, in my view, is true. The deal that David Cameron got from the EU was basically words. It meant nothing. It's not going to stop the process of integration in the EU. It's not going to effectively give Great Britain any more say in what happens in the EU and how much Britain is affected by it. So that part is a problem. Cameron did not get what he promised he would get negotiating with the EU.
So thank you, sir, for your presentation. But I wanted to ask a question pertaining to the geopolitics between the EU and other major world powers. And the former president of the European Commission, José Manuel Barroso, provided an interesting argument about how each European country, whether it be Germany or France or the United Kingdom, how it's in their benefit to be a part of the European Union, to have more bargaining power on the international stage. So what do you have to say about that? Is there a benefit to being a part of the EU for that reason, or?
Certainly there, so the question was, the question referred to a very, very common argument within the EU, by the way, namely that we have to stick together, otherwise we're all too small and we won't have any power and influence anyway. That's the basic argument. Is that argument valid? Well, certainly in many ways, yes. I mean, if the EU really, you know, is going to work together and you know, be a bigger entity, single entity with a single voice and so forth, yes, it will give the individual member states more power. Just one example of that. It's no surprise, I mean, I was in Luxembourg for a year at the U.S. Embassy there, and, you know, the Luxembourgers are one of the most pro-EU countries in the EU. Well, that makes sense. I mean, Luxembourg has 500,000 people. I once, you know, was a potted plant at a meeting between George Bush and all of the EU leaders in which Jean-Claude Juncker, the Prime Minister of Luxembourg at the time, was presiding over that meeting. So he was representing the whole, all of Europe to the US president because Luxembourg had the 6-month rotating presidency of the EU. Now, how many times are you going to find some person who heads a country of 500,000 represent an entire continent to the head of, you know, the United States. So yes, there's validity to that argument, but there's a lot less validity to that argument than one would think. I mean, that's what they say about Brexit, for example, too. Oh, if great, and by the way, my view on Brexit is whatever the British people decide, I will respect. I'm not saying, you know, that Great Britain should leave the EU. I think we should respect what the Brits decide for themselves. Anyway, everybody's saying, oh, if the Brits leave, if we leave the EU, we're not going to have a place at the table. Well, you know, having a place at the table and a table of 28, even if you do have weighted votes, you do have weighted votes according to population and so forth, doesn't necessarily mean all that much. And it certainly doesn't mean as much as having your own government decide on your own policy and your own laws, and also deciding on how your own country cooperates with the rest of the world. That is much more power for real voters, real citizens, than working together within the supranational institution that is independent of the member states in many ways, and that has its own supranational agenda, which involves weakening and slowly eroding the sovereignty of the member states. Not because they don't like the member states, but because they believe it's the best thing for the world.
Hi, Todd. David Kreminga. And perhaps it's in the book, but I'm just wondering if you could comment on very rapid inclusion of Central and Eastern European countries into the EU. And also, which I remember actually being cheered by the United States as a way of tethering these countries to the West. And what effect has that had on the viability of the EU in its governance?
Good question. And by the way, many, many years ago, David Kreminga and I spent time together on a Calvin interim abroad to Germany, in both West Germany and East Germany. So I guess you could say both, you know, the Western and the Eastern part of what is now the EU, as you asked about. I think that, first of all, the U.S. has always said, George W. Bush, you know, the one everybody wants to hate, said, we want a Europe whole and free. The United States officially supports the European Union and European integration. The reason for that, in my view, is because American foreign policy practitioners are too busy to think about long-range implications. We need the EU right now to help us finance whatever in Afghanistan, or to help us talk to, you know, Pakistan and get Pakistan to do what we want, et cetera. We don't have time to worry about long-term implications. So we're going to support our friends right now, no matter what. That, to me, is the reason. And one of the weaknesses of U.S. foreign policy. It's too driven by day-to-day events. There's not enough time to think about it. So supporting a Europe whole and free and supporting the Central and Eastern European countries joining the EU is something that any U.S. government would have done. In the sense of propelling free market reforms and judicial reforms and other policy reforms in the newly freed countries of the former Soviet orbit, joining the EU was a good thing, probably. They were forced to do reforms to make their countries more free and more well-functioning and less corrupt in order to join the EU. There's all kinds of criteria for joining the EU. So in that sense, it was a good thing. Also, it's understandable that the Central and Eastern Europeans wanted to do that because they associate the EU with Western Europe and the United States, with NATO, with freedom. Fortunately, de facto, they're still correct. I mean, one thing I do want to try to make clear is, despite what I'm talking about in terms of what the EU wants and what the EU is doing slowly, that the member states of the European Union are still good friends of the United States, and they're still democracies. They're getting less and less democratic, but they're still democracies. However, now the Central and Eastern European states, many of them,
Poland, Hungary, and many others, are noticing that they've kind of given up being dominated by the Soviet Union to be dominated by a new hegemon that is certainly not even a fraction as bad as the Soviet Union, but that nevertheless does want to tell them how their democracy should develop and how they should be more supranationalist than they are. And it's very complicated to figure out what's happening in Hungary right now, for example. Very, very complicated. And there's a lot of really bad things that the Hungarian government is doing. But still, the Hungarian government is not incorrect in exercising its legal powers, for example, to write a new constitution, which it did when it had the support in order to do that. And it's within its rights to say, we want to be Hungary, and we don't want to accept, for example, this and this number of migrants because the EU says we have to. So Central and Eastern European countries are kind of noticing this. And the final part of your question was, if I recall, was how has it affected the functioning of the European Union? It's made it considerably more complicated. Right before the enlargement to the Eastern member states, it was 15 member states, all of them Western European, more similar to each other. Within one fell swoop, it became 25 member states. And then later, Romania and Bulgaria joined, it became 27. Now it's Croatia joined, so now it's 28. And close to half of them are Central and Eastern European. So there's a big clash of cultures now going on within the EU. And I think that is partially, or let's say this, it's at least exacerbated the problems of supranational governance. It's exacerbated the Eurozone problems, the migrant crisis problems, et cetera. So maybe kind of the supranationalist dream is on its way to reaching its limits. Maybe you can kind of do it with 15 Western European states, but maybe not do it with the entire continent.
Hello, my name is Catherine. Two quick questions. I wondered how does the European Union define child? And number two, I find the most disturbing thing about this is that the European Council are not elected. And if they're not elected, how are they chosen? How are they appointed?
Yeah. I gotta tell you, I don't know exactly the legal definition that they use for child when they, for example, define child according to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. But it's actually the UN who I hope defined it in some way. I imagine it's, you know, people under 18 or people under 21, but I don't know the exact age. And this is one of the problems with the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, and one of the problems with all international agreements, actually. And by that, I'm not saying that all international agreements are bad, but one thing you have to realize about international agreements is they're almost always kind of vague. They leave a lot of stuff out. Part of that is constructive ambiguity, right? If you can't really agree with another country, then you can kind of reach an agreement anyway if you kind of be wishy-washy in certain clauses. That's constructive in the sense of actually making good agreements sometimes, but it's also quite destructive if it leaves kind of a way open for bad agendas to get further pushed in the international arena. And so the other question was the European Council. Well, actually, the European Council is made up of the European member state heads of state and government. That's the most intragovernmental EU institution. The EU is a hybrid, right? The European Commission, which has the most day-to-day power and the most regulatory power, the lawmaking power in the EU, is unelected. That's completely unelected. The European Council is elected. It's the heads of state, and the Council of Ministers below it are the ministers of the national governments. But remember, the European Council has a president who's not one of them, who's not a member of a national government. So you get the European Council, the heads of state, they're actually supposedly led by a president who's not elected and who represents the EU as one of its two presidents.
Other questions? Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. I'm Henk-Jan van Schotthorst from the Netherlands, co-founder of the Transatlantic Christian Council. And I want to congratulate you with this excellent analysis of the EU. As a former staffer in the European Parliament for 7 years, I fully underwrite and share and agree with all the conclusions. And it is strange that an American is to remind Europeans, as well as Americans, on the problems. But what I want to ask, one single question, is on which kind of solutions do you have to the problems you mentioned in your book? Is there a way out? What should be done? So a way forward.
First of all, I want to say that just like my daughter was not coached, my friend Henk Jan is not a plant. I didn't tell him to say that. Thank you, Henk Jan, for saying that. I'll give you the $10 later. Anyway, what's the solution? You know, that of course is the $64,000 question. What's the solution? The solution is going to be very difficult. I believe that the West is in a real crisis. And that's one of the main points I make in my book, is that it's not just the European Union, it's also the United States. We have no right as Americans to be going, oh, those stupid Europeans, you know, they don't get it, we're better. Not the case. The West shares this crisis, and the crisis is a kind of a loss of civilizational energy. There's a civilizational exhaustion that's happening in the West. We no longer believe in what sustained us, what built us, in the things that were behind all of the things that we've built. We no longer believe, in other words, in the Judeo-Christian worldview, or actually the Christian religion, the Christian faith itself. But even the Judeo-Christian worldview, that's now falling away. And so we don't have anything to replace it with. And nature abhors a vacuum. You know, and I think that's why the global governance ideology has such an appeal in Europe and also among American academics. If you look at what professors, political science professors throughout the United States are writing, it's all about global governance and it's all this stuff. Nature abhors a vacuum. People need something to believe in. We no longer believe in ourselves and our faith. So we're going to global governance in Europe much more than the United States. But I'll never forget being surprised one time reading a speech that Bill Clinton gave shortly after he had left the presidency in London. And he was talking about global governance and how, you know, Americans shouldn't believe in national sovereignty and all that kind of stuff. I could not believe that a president of the United States, former president of the United States, was saying that. And that was already, you know, probably 2002, 2003. That was a long time ago. So this exerts an attraction. What I think we need to do is I think we need to find a way to come back to a cultural consensus about what made the West what it is. And I think that cultural consensus, at the very least, is the belief in a Judeo-Christian view of human beings, right? That people are of great dignity, of equal dignity. They are worthy and they are capable of great good, but yet they are flawed. We can't reach paradise on this world. We need to deal with the flaws in humanity and limit government and limit everything else, because any concentration of power is going to be abused by sinful, or if you put it culturally, flawed human beings. So we need to come back to that consensus. How to do that, I do not know. I mean, I personally believe part of it is mission work. I mean, the biggest part of it is mission work, you know. But, you know, we want to preserve what we have politically, economically, and socially also, even though undoubtedly or probably people are not going to kind of go back to the Christian faith, let's say. So it's more difficult than the difference between, let's say, Democrats and Republicans, because it's about the very nature and the very purpose of politics. What is politics about? Is politics about building a better world than can ever be built, or is it about Is it about providing a rule of law and a framework within which people can exercise their freedom, their responsibility, and their dignity in a way that's good for the rest of society, realizing it'll never be perfect? It's about that purpose of politics, you know?
This will be our last question.
I think you addressed part of my question. I was going to ask, why are Europeans, or what's the nature of Europeans that makes them so eager to give up their individual liberty and an economic freedom and private property rights to this banal group of people in the EU, these progressives that want to, anti-democratic types of people in the EU that want to tell other people how to live their lives. And I think maybe you could build a little more on what you just said to address that. And it, my other question has to do with the Islamic penetration of Western Europe, the no-go zones, the Sharia law, and to what extent Islam is a threat to European governments, individual countries, and the EU also.
Thank you. So why do Europeans want to give up so much of their individual freedom and free markets and so forth? I think it basically comes down to a very, very complex difference between Europeans and Americans in general, that Europeans, and it has to do with the balance between freedom and equality, I think. Americans tend to, this is changing, but Americans tend to value freedom and equality of opportunity over equality of outcome. I think Europeans do too, actually. I think they do value that more. But they value equality of outcome enough that they believe deeply, in a cultural sense, that everybody has to work together in order to try to improve equality of outcome, and that people should be willing to limit their freedom and their equality of opportunity in order to promote more equality of outcome, in order to fight poverty, et cetera. And this is a balance where we and the Europeans disagree. And I think that's separate, really, from the EU thing. I think the Europeans would be that way even if there were no EU. And, you know, one of the interesting things for me about being a diplomat is that, you know, you learn when you are in different countries and deal with different people that different people have different preferences for their societies, and they have a right to manage their societies in that way. You know, black and white and all that, the interesting thing about black and white is that there's really so little of it, right? There's the black and the white, and in the middle is this big gray zone. And what's really hard is trying to find the red lines, you know? But I think in terms of freedom and all of that in general, the Europeans are still within the same red lines as the Americans, and let's hope that it stays that way. I think Islam is a huge threat to Europe, but I'm not saying that in an anti-Muslim way. I'm saying that in the sense that Islam is a growing and vibrant religion represented in the EU by a lot higher proportion of young people than there are Europeans who are young people. And Muslims are coming to the EU in huge numbers, and they're also having more children than Europeans. And the Europeans don't have anything with which to fight the anti-democratic and non-Western, let's say, implications of Islam. Why? Because of civilizational exhaustion again. The Europeans really don't believe in themselves. They believe in global governance, you know, kind of this future vision, but they really don't believe in themselves. They don't have a strong, vibrant, credible worldview with which to attract Muslims who have moved to Europe or who live in Europe. And thus there is a huge culture clash with Muslims, and it will continue, in my view, and it will get worse.
Ladies and gentlemen, join me in thanking Todd. So. Excellent, excellent. Very good job. Thank you.